right here in this book is some extremely important information that really points out what's happening today and warns us and clarifies it. I've spent 38 years with this book studying it. And it's helped clarify what is taking place in this world. Essentially, what is being offered to the world is this so-called, quote-unquote, compromise, where we can integrate truth and lies and make them both true. And this is impossible. This is the worst defense possible for us in terms that we're most vulnerable to it, and it has the worst outcome for us. So this book, A Course in Miracles, by Jesus, who's a very straight talker, very straight shooter, tells you directly, doesn't try to equivocate. So you can trust in Jesus, what he has to say. He tells you straight out, you know, what's what, actually. And does not speaking in parables, not you know, just very direct right now, very direct. And we are in an absolute crisis on this planet because this so-called compromise between truth and arrogance, truth and lies, arrogance is nothing but a lie, okay? This compromise has become viral on this planet to the point where, you know, a great percentage of this planet sees this as their salvation. And this is such a wrong path to take. It is so disastrous to take this path that Jesus alerted us very much so, and said, you must prepare so you're not deceived by what arrogance is going to spring upon the world. Now, also in this book, Journey Beyond Words, also by Jesus, Jesus has pointed out some just tremendous truths. One of them that he insists upon is that we are spirit. We're not a body, we're spirit. We're neither male nor female. There's absolutely no such thing as gender in reality at all. So what we're sharing with here is being shared from spirit to spirit. It's not from a male to a male, male to female, anything like that. It's spirit to spirit. And what we're being called to do is to be smart, be really smart. All of us can be really smart. We're all spirit, actually. The body that we're identifying with does not negate the fact that we are spirit, we're perfect, and we're extremely intelligent and can understand this. Now, it's very important to realize part of the reason why people are caving in to this compromise solution that arrogance presents to us is they believe that the goal of salvation, eternal life, etc., is just too difficult to reach. They say, I it's impossible, I can't do it. And so it's very important to say that is not true. It is not impossible. So in order to not cave in to this very devious compromise trick that arrogance is pushing on this world, what you have to do is you have to hang in there and you say, you know what, even though it seems impossible, it's not. I know it's not. That's just a trick of arrogance. That is, you know, it's like a self-delusion that somehow the logic of arrogance is reaching this conclusion for me. And even though the logic seems accurate, the premise, it tries to hide the premise. The premise is wrong. And so what arrogance tries to do is it tries to confuse the premise so you don't see what the premise is. So therefore, you're only looking at the logic that stems from that premise. And you draw, you know, you say, oh, it must be right then. Oh, okay, it must be impossible to get free, you know, of arrogance and et cetera, et cetera. So what you have to do is you have to realize, hey, you know what? The problem is the premise. The premise is the problem. And I know it's wrong. I know the premise of arrogance, which says that arrogance is true and truth is arrogance, is wrong. But I can't quite see. It's all murky for me. I still can't quite see it. Fine. You can clear up the murkiness. It takes an effort, for sure. But you absolutely can do it, and you have to do it. Okay, there's no way to default and say, I can't do it, I can never do it. It's impossible. You have to do it. Because the goal of arrogance is never reached. It's never reached. It remains just nothing but sheer arrogance. You know, a lie, an impossibility, a non-existent nothingness. So what you have to do is keep the faith. Keep the faith, keep the faith, keep the faith, keep the faith. And just say, you know, it's just a matter of work. I just have to keep working at it. And if it, you know, however long it takes me, that's how long it takes me. But I'm not going to fall into this dastardly trap that is being presented in this world as if it were a no-brainer, an obvious, you know, thing to do. And the world is populated by a mindset right now of people who are so enthusiastic about this false, compromise, arrogant, so-called, you know, remedy for our troubles. Full of people like this. So it's a very trying time for any of us who recognize otherwise, because they have all these very, you know, clever slogans and ways to shout you down and all this kind of stuff. So it's really difficult for us to have a voice in the marketplace of ideas right now. The voice of reason is it doesn't have a voice in the marketplace of ideas in this contemporary culture at all. You don't see anybody in the marketplace of ideas mainstream that has any really reason to them at all. Maybe real weak, diluted kind of time, but not real strong, real clear reason that which could really put this compromise, false plan, this false salvation of arrogance, really put it in proper perspective. And you know, now this is the job of you know, those who are wise, and there have been institutions built around the wise, what the wise knew and know. And those institutions are extremely important to keep refreshing them and keep them from, they get watered down over time. You need to keep, you know, keep evaporating some of the watered downness of it. And so it's a very difficult time. But you have to try and just keep the faith. So you know what? I am going to awaken from this self-delusion someday. And I know that I know I can do it. I know it's not impossible. I know the logic of arrogance has false premises. It's completely false from the very beginning. And I know I'm just deceiving myself. I know the only problem I have is continuity fear. I know all this, so I'm not going to cave in to the, you know, the sloganeering of these, you know, childish, you know, morons, really, who you know, just saturated with arrogance right now, and thinking they're so clever, you know, so clever that they feel they've won. You know, they shut down the voice of reason in this world. Well, the voice of reason is patient and loving and kind and will share truth. But if there are people who simply shout it down and don't want to listen to it, then you know that's. That's their problem. It's not like we've lost the voice of reason. It's within all of us. So we will see what happens to all of this, for sure. We're not crushed or defeated in any way. Keep that in mind. I guarantee you that Jesus is not defeated, and all those who also have freed themselves from arrogance entirely, they are also not defeated at all. They're not crushed. They're not deceived. They're not misled. So you have those supporting you in some way. How they do this is still kind of a mystery to us. But they do support us, and they support us by, you know, for instance, giving us these, you know, great books. That's tremendous support. But you have to study them. You have to apply it. You have to let it sink in. And it's a difficult task. But keep in mind that people throughout history have spent their lives studying the works of the wise here in this world. They spent their time studying it. So they have put in the time. That's how you have to do it. You have to put in the time and the effort and the sincerity. The path must be, you must be, path is paved with sincerity, real sincerity, which I call the mood of repentance. It's paved with the mood of repentance, realizing, you know, I'm under the spell of this terrible belief system of arrogance, and I know I'm not doing what I really want to do, and I need to get free of this spell. This is the mood of repentance. And also you realize there is a way to do it. So it isn't a matter, it is absolutely true that you say, I'm under the spell of this arrogance still. And you can't say, oh, well, it's impossible for me to do it, therefore maybe I'm not under the spell. Maybe it isn't arrogance, you know. You can't do that, because that's not the mood of repentance. The mood of repentance knows that it's possible to get free of arrogance, and knows that it must do so. And so this puts one under a totally different mood than the rest of the world. Very sober, very sober, very modest, very sober. Realizing, wow, if I don't get free of this arrogance, it's going to continue to bite me forever, you know, until I get free of it. And there's no such default of saying, oh, it's impossible to get free of it, therefore that just proves that it's perfect, or that somehow that means that arrogance has won, and if I can take part in that winning, what the prize is, etc. There's no such thing as that. God pays no attention to arrogance, actually. God is not in any contest with arrogance whatsoever. God is perfection. Perfection is not in any contest with imperfection. There is no such thing. This is the central delusion that there's some contest. And I remember when I was in this abiding in non-duality for a while, I saw all these people running past me and yelling, all these spirits are so enthusiastic, and they pointed to the future, and they were journeying to the future, and there was this light show going on, and then there was this dark cloud, and the light show was trying to, you know, somehow defeat the dark cloud. And they wanted to be part of the winning side, you know. Well, there are no sides to God. There's no winning side to God. There's just God. God just is. Perfection just is. There's no contest taking place. There's no contest taking place at all with God, with reality. No contest. There's no winners, no losers, no light, no dark, so to speak. It's all the light of perfection, the light of perfect freedom is all that it is. So to go into the future thinking that you're going to win and against, you know, some enemy, the darkness, and you know, that's delusion. That's total delusion. This is arrogance. This is arrogance. So really, you can be enlightened right now. There's nothing, there's no winning that has to take place. We are perfect right now, this very instant. Our being is perfect. Our spirit is perfect. There's no winning that has to take place. There's an awakening from the spell of winning and losing, that dualistic spell that needs to take place. Yeah, but there's no winning that has to take place. There's no residue of awakening. Well, you know, there's not like there's when you awaken, there's some loser there. No. So you're not a winner, you're not a loser. So maybe you have to practice this. It's if you want to have safety from what's taking place in the world, just keep your spiritual practice going. This is the safety. Hang out with the saints, the enlightened ones. This is the safety. It's always been that way in the world. Always. Read their words, you know. Just hang out with those who are speaking truth, and practice, and you're, whenever you can, always be saying some affirmation. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is protection. This is protection. This has been used throughout history. Do your spiritual practice, prayers, etc. This is protection from the insane defenses that arrogance uses to try and convince you to go along with what it is advising. So again, we're neither male nor female. We're spirit, and we're all wise, actually, and we're certainly wise enough to practice and realize that we can get free of this spell of arrogance. Absolutely we can, and we must. And we realize that there's a very devious trap that's been set here in this world, and we certainly don't want to fall into it. So what I'm doing is I'm spreading the knowledge of this trap and how to not fall into it. So the arrogance, those who are drunk on arrogance, you know, they're you ever tried to talk to someone who's extremely drunk? You realize you just have to wait till they sober up. There's nothing you can say. There's nothing you can really say. So they're so drunk on arrogance that there's nothing we can say to them. And then of course they take this as saying, "Oh, you don't have anything to say. This proves that you don't have anything to say." You know, it's kind of like, imagine someone who wanted to, let's say there's a wise person and someone wanted to try and prove that they were stupid. So what do they do? They get absolutely falling down drunk and they can't even talk or think or anything. And then they go to the wise person and says, "Oh, you know, you don't like the way I am. You don't think I'm smart." And the wise person says, "Oh, nothing I can say because you're so out of it there that you can't understand. You have to be sober to understand the truth." And then imagine if the drunk person then said, "Well, this just proves that you're stupid because you don't have anything to say." This is what's happening in the world. Like, because of the people in the mainstream public eye right now are so drunk on arrogance that they cannot understand a word of truth or wisdom right now. And so, what's the point in hitting your head against a wall? It's futile. This is the trick that they're using on us. And of course, sometimes it makes us feel like we're like, that we are like incompetent or stupid or something. We should be able to help them. No, if someone's willing to intoxicate themselves on the folly of arrogance to such an extreme extent they can't understand a word of truth, then that's on them. That's their problem. That's their fault. And it doesn't mean that we are stupid at all. So this is one of their most devious tricks that they're using right now. And you think, wow, the people of of reason in this world have lost their reason and they don't have it anymore and they're stupid and stuff. No, they just stop trying because you realize waste of time and effort and energy and you get nothing out of it. You have to wait till they sober up. And you gotta wonder too, what's it gonna take to help these folks sober up? You know, they seem like they've gone all in now, all in. And I look at all these comments in the world, and the mood of everyone, and I realize there's nothing I can say to them that's going to make any difference at this point. I once got a call from somebody that was so they were so drunk, they could not understand anything I had to say. I felt so incompetent. You know, they made me feel very incompetent because I wanted to help them, but I couldn't. What could I do? There's nothing. So if somebody wants to play this game of "you're stupid because you can't get through to me," and by intoxicating themselves so severely, well, they're going to have to recognize that's a pretty stupid game to play. And we're going to have to stop feeling guilty or wrong about our incapacity. This is the one that I feel is the biggest challenge here in this world right now. Is those who are wise enough to help out, they have to stop feeling, you know, guilty or wrong or incompetent because they're not able to help out as much as they would like. Because there's an intentional effort on the part of arrogance to play stupid, to play dumb. To be completely intoxicated with arrogance, okay? That's strategy, trying to break our will, you know? So, hey, no, we will remain absolutely clear until they sober up. And again, what's it going to take to sober them up? Oftentimes, you know, some raving alcoholics, they hit bottom before they sober up. And even then, they may want to stay on the bottom for a while. It's quite a difficult thing. Turning the corner can often be quite difficult when you're stuck in severe arrogance. Don't try and convince these people of the errors of their ways at this time. They I've seen for so long that they are, you know, it's like they're in a cocoon of asbestos, you know, that wards off all truth. They've wrapped themselves up in the rags of arrogance to such an extent, you know, that they're playing dead to truth. You know, this is their little game. They're playing dead to responsibility. And they have the power, being spirit, to pull this off and appear to be, you know, completely resistant to truth, which is what arrogance is really trying to do. Is it's trying to prove that it is absolutely resistant to truth, that truth cannot permeate it. So those that go along with arrogance, what do? They try to show off and prove that they're impervious to truth. And why should we continue to play this game? Knowing what the game is, you know, why should we even play it? You know, they're going to have to wait until they sober up. But let's be clear about what this game is that they're playing. Arrogance believes it's in a contest with God. It's not, but it believes that, and it believes it has to win. If it doesn't win, it's going to annihilate. How does arrogance win this contest with God? By proving that it's impervious to truth. That truth cannot move it in the slightest bit. The truth sounds like complete gibberish to it. Impervious to it. Untouched by it. Arrogance wants to prove it's untouched by truth. But keep in mind, we're the ones playing this game. And we are truth. We are as God created us. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So we were literally abiding in with truth. We can't separate ourselves from it. Is this still going? That was really weird. Just this whole screen went blank and then went on again. Yeah. So when you play along with arrogance, what you're really doing is you're trying to make yourself impervious to truth, completely separate from it, untouched by it. And you find yourself, if that's your goal, you find yourself here in a world thinking you're a body, among others who think they're here in a world in a body. Talking a bunch of nonsense and wasting time and just trying to be as stupid as possible, actually. But this is the goal of arrogance. The goal of arrogance is to be as stupid as possible, to be, you know, as resistant as possible to truth. So these people in the world now, there's so many, the world's inundated by them. They're here to show off. This is their victory, you know, celebration that's underway in this world now, the, you know, victory celebration. They finally believe that they've become impervious to truth. Now, we don't know exactly how far they'll take it, yeah, but it gets very, very painful when you take it far enough. It becomes very severe. Ultimately, it results in total mental chaos, and then that wakes you up. You say, "Uh-oh." That's as far as I can go, and I'm still wise. Truth is still with me. And then they say, that's it. Okay, game's up. That's it. And then they have to set the game down. It takes a while. But collectively, this planet now is in this, you know, massive state of trying to prove that they're impervious to truth. That's the fad that's raging on this planet right now. In order to seem to be hip and involved, you know, and have a life on this planet, you have to sort of showcase your imperviousness to truth here. So that's why everybody, the way they talk, they just completely leave God wisdom out of all their talk and interactions. They're like, it doesn't exist. And I look at the world and I say, what is this, an insane asylum, a complete madhouse? You know, You're just missing your opportunities right and left, right and left. Well, now I understand that's the whole purpose of it, is to avoid your opportunities and try to prove that truth can't touch you. And we, in arrogance, believes that once that becomes a reality, that means that arrogance has won this contest with God, and now arrogance is the new prime creator. And that the will of arrogance is now supreme, and that God has been defeated. So, the main dynamic that I'm finding and understanding here is that it's very tough for us to accept that we cannot help many in this world, because they're intentionally trying to prove that we can't help them. And when they're in that mood, it seems as though you just have to wait. You can't force it, that's for sure. I want to talk to everybody I see. But I've never been able to say a word to anybody as I walk in the street and the stores and everything. You can't say anything. Because if you do, they'll get very frightened and upset and say, oh my gosh, truth just touched me. That's terrible. I'm losing. I'm going to be annihilated. So arrogance tells us that if we lose this contest with God, we'll be annihilated. That's its logic. So people are willing to, you know, use phrases, spiritual phrases and various things, as long as they don't really put it together and see what it's really pointing towards. And you see a lot of that in the Bible study throughout history, is people can quote this and this and this and this and this, but you realize they don't understand what it means, and they haven't really put it into the right context. They haven't put it all together at all. And I say, how can they not see this? That Jesus said that God is a spirit, and is only, you must worship in spirit and truth. Okay, that's what God is looking for, is those who worship God in spirit and truth. This is the words of Jesus. So, I believe in John. And people don't get that. They keep thinking that God made us as bodies, you know, and it just there's so much they don't put together. Well, this is typical of those who are still caught up in the goals of arrogance, trying to avoid what they think is their annihilation, losing a contest with God. They're able to use the superficial phrases and this and this and that, and sound like they're spiritual, but they don't really let it touch them. And so what they're really doing, isn't it, is actually proving that truth can't touch them. They don't realize they're still in this mode of not letting truth touch them. So they can win. They think that winning is their salvation, is the only salvation they can see possible, is they must defeat God in this contest. And what we're saying here is there is no contest. There is no contest. Of course, a contest is the only way that spirit can entertain the idea of being greater than God, which is the idea that started all this nonsense. So spirit has to feel that perfection is something, that reality is something that is up for grabs. You know, whoever wins a contest, you know, whoever, let's make this it's kind of like there's this various contests of something that's contested. Throughout history, there have been contests, and we say we have something very important here. Let's decide it by a contest. You claim it, and I both claim it. So let's have a contest, and the winner, they get the prize. They get the prize. So we've imagined that there's this contest that we're engaged in with God, and the truth is we're not engaged in any contest at all. But as long as we believe we're engaged in a contest, keep this in mind, duality is very tricky. Because as soon as you put truth as something to be won through winning a contest, you automatically say that the loser doesn't have truth anymore, you see? The loser doesn't have truth. You can't have two winners. You know, when you have a contest, you have a winner and a loser. So you believe that's possible to lose out on reality, to lose out on perfection. And so we automatically create this massive fear within us that, like, what if I lose? Oh my gosh, what if I lose? So we're frightening ourselves for no reason at all, because there isn't any contest. So it's exasperating in this world when you see people who use spiritual phrases and you think, oh, okay, I can talk with them. You talk with them and you realize, you know, that they don't understand at all. Like, they haven't been touched by it. They haven't been touched by the truth. When you're touched by the truth, then you're able to start putting it all together. You know, you see how it all fits together and you say, wow. When you're touched by truth, it's a big wow. It's a big way. It's not all this emotionalism and drama that those who are faking it, who pretend to be touched by it. You've seen it all. I've seen it all too. And I've observed so much in this world. Sort of a lifetime of being educated in various ways. And you listen to the, you know, even to get some preacher giving a sermon and this and that. And the way they do it, you know, they kind of act like, you know, if they speak in a certain voice, that means it's true, or it means that I understand what I'm talking about, and you do too, because you're listening to this voice like this, and the way they go at it is so emotional and drama and all this stuff, and I say, why are they doing that? You know, that's not the way. Well, it's a way to, it's called, you know, overcompensating, because if you're faking something, you want to pretend that, you know, try to hide this fact. And so they're not letting the truth touch them. And yet they're reacting like, oh my gosh, you know, drama, this, so, you know, but it's not really touching them. They're not being touched by it. And this is what I've always noticed. I said, wow. This is so odd. You know, why are they doing this? This is so bizarre. Now we know. We're here in this teaching. What I'm suggesting is this wow. This is a full walking together in the wow. The wow means you've been touched by it, and you can feel it. You've been touched by it. It's not an emotional kind of thing. Okay. It's more like a wow. Like you just say, wow. This is just. I can't even put it into words, you know, so profound I just can't put it into words. I've really been touched by this idea, by this clarity. I've really been impacted by it severely. This is how progress is made. And believe me, those people who have been listening to those, you know, Bible-thumping preachers who make it all so dramatic and stuff like that, as if some great truth is being imparted therein. You see them later in life, you evaluate and look at them, and they haven't gone anywhere. They haven't gone anywhere. You have to be actually touched by not any physical body, but by your own clarity. Your own clarity, you have to stun yourself with your own clarity. You have to stun yourself with your own mental clarity. It has nothing to do with any special relationship. It has to do with your own mental clarity, where you recognize, you glimpse for yourself, wow, I see how I've been tricking myself, wow. And they realize the vast implications of that, and this hits you. The vast implications hit you, and this is the wow. This means you've been touched by truth. You see the implications. You say, wow, if I've been doing this, then that means I've been, oh my gosh. It's stunning. It just hits you so hard. This is the real path. Okay, this is real religion. This is the real path. Most of the religion throughout history is just fake. It's just they're faking it. They're not being touched by it. They're pretending to be touched by it, but they're not. They may be jumping up and shouting and yelling and all this kind of stuff, but they're not being touched by it actually. When you're really touched by the truth, you just want to sit quietly. You don't want to even move. You don't want to say, hardly say anything. You just say, like, wow. This is so extraordinary. So I say, practice sitting quietly. And the more you do this, the more comfortable you get with this, the easier it is then to be touched by truth, because you know, I can sit here quietly. I can be stunned. It's okay. Because the truth is stunning in a quiet way. It's not a bunch of pyrotechnics. You just catch a glimpse, and then you just like that instant, you say, oh, okay, that's it, I see it, wow. And you can just be totally quiet about it. But it's somewhere within you, you know, you're shaking, like in you're like just in a state of again, elation, trepidation, kind of just reverberating, like you just some big gong has been struck, and just wow. A lot of people try to fake this wow through drugs, okay? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Try to fake it. Again, why are they faking it? So they're not really touched by truth. Why are they don't want to be touched by truth? Because the goal of arrogance, again, is to win, and thinking that if it doesn't win, it's going to lose against God. And the way to win against God, arrogance tells us, is to eventually become completely impervious to truth. So arrogance believes we spend our time practicing being untouched by truth. So we may read spiritual book, but then we try to practice, oh, I'm not going to be touched by that. You see, that can't touch me. So you might spend a lot of time in spiritual study, but it's really designed to show that you're untouched by it. You try to practice being untouched by it. And we've probably all done that, okay? Because this is so prevalent, we don't even realize it. We do not even realize it. We try to avoid that wow feeling at all costs. And we try to ignore it when it does arise. We try to ignore it, which is why I say it's very important to recognize it. Which I say, don't use stimulants, because stimulants help you ignore it, the wow feeling. Okay? They help you ignore it. And this, again, you're trying to prove to yourself that you're impervious to truth, that truth doesn't touch you. You can read truth and it just doesn't touch me, you know. So you just ignore the wow factor. But if you don't use any drugs or stimulants and you're so very sober, you will feel the wow and say, oh, it's there. Oh, wow. I can feel it. And then you say, you are being touched by truth. That's why people, you know, afraid of Jesus. They say, I don't want to see Jesus. Well, I might be touched, feel that I'm really touched by the truth, and then I'm going to lose. I'm going to lose my contest with God, you know. And so stay away, Jesus, stay away. I don't want to get, you know, near. I might really feel, you know, the truth, be touched by it. And it's just astonishing, but this is true. So I've never seen this before like this so clearly. This is a big, it's a wow for me. This is really what's been happening. I've been so baffled by it. So why are people so stupid? What are they? They're spouting all this stuff like they know what they're talking about, but they don't. They don't put it together. It hasn't sunk in. Why is that? Why hasn't that sunk in? And then in talking to them, I find that they don't want to get clear about it at all. So it's very baffling. But now we know what it is, where it comes from. So it's not always those who are talking, spouting spirituality. It's not always those who you can approach and talk with at all. It might be someone who's just, you know, just quiet, never says anything. Because oftentimes those who are posing spiritually, oftentimes. They're just testing themselves to see how well they can manage not to be touched by truth. That's why Jesus said, not all who say Jesus, Jesus, Jesus shall inherit the kingdom. Not all, you see. Some are being touched by truth, some are not when they say that. Some are practicing, you know, how to become impervious to truth. So this is quite something, a big wow. Sort of like a mystery that's been uncovered finally. This is something that's bothered me my whole life. I just could not understand the perversity of this world in terms of, you know, you think that somebody's open for truth, and you speak and they become furious with you. How dare you try to touch me, you know, with truth? I'm trying to avoid it. I said, well, why are you trying to avoid it? You're trying to, why? You know, what, but you seem to be, you know, interested in it, but they're only interested in it to try to build up their immunity to it. So this is a devastating indictment of the world, and it's true. But it's better to know it than not know it. Jesus covered this in the parable of the sower, and saying that some seeds the sower throws will land on rocks, some on shallow soil, some in a wick thicket of weeds, and others will find fertile soil. So not everyone that hears truth is interested in it, and even those who claim to be interested in it are not always interested in it. They may be just practicing how to be impervious to it. But if you're having this wow feelings, then you know you're the one where the seeds are falling on fertile soil. Because glimpsing the truth inevitably produces this wow feeling, because the implications are so staggering. And it completely flips the script that you're used to. So as much as possible, keep practicing going into this wow feeling. Allow it to happen. Now, I didn't always allow that to happen. I tried not to. So I know that we it's not that easy for us to allow. It's just a subtle thing. But you're basically admitting, you know, you're really being touched by truth. And this admission for us is extremely taboo according to what we're used to. Or the advice of arrogance tells us at all costs. Avoid this feeling at all costs. Avoid this feeling. Very amazing. Very sobering. I wish I'd have known this long ago. I wouldn't have had such a terrible life. Kept trying, hitting your head against the wall your whole life. But in order to see this, you really have to understand what's going, the big picture here of this idea of a contest where reality is something that is up for grabs, and the one who grabs it first wins, and the one who doesn't grab it first loses. So we think if we don't, you know, prove that we're greater than God, that we'll lose. And we're trying to do it by proving we're impervious to God, to truth, to reality. And we spend our lives, in the way we spend our lives is mostly trying to do things that help us become more impervious to truth. Don't you oftentimes wonder, why did I do that? Why am I acting this way? I can't figure it out. It's crazy. I don't understand. Well, now we understand. This is the overriding motivation of most in this world, really, is to use your time, use time to try to become impervious to God. What else is time for? Reality doesn't need time. So why else would you be using time except to try to be impervious to reality? Now, we can flip the script and use time to become accepting of reality once again instead of trying to be impervious to it. But once we have accepted reality, we don't need time. Reality itself doesn't need time at all. Reality is not trying to become impervious to reality. And again, the compromise solution that we're told in the world now is by Big Mother is yeah, you can both be impervious to reality and accept reality, both at the same time. Yeah, look at the insanity of that statement, right? You can both be completely accepting and touched by reality, completely abiding in reality, and at the same time, the same moment, be absolutely impervious to it. This is what the compromise solution that people are falling for in this world, that's what it's saying. And obviously you realize that is absolute madness. And yet it dresses this madness, you know, puts lipstick on this pig. A massive amount of lipstick is being put on this pig. And they're dressing the pig up in finery and posting about it and praising the pig and worshiping the pig and saying what an awesome solution this is, you know, incredible. Why didn't we see it before? Oh, of course this is the answer. Both are true. We say, well, both are true. There's a new truth. Both truth and lies are true. We've got the new truth now. This is the new way, the new style. This is the new world order, the new world religion. This is the new truth. And they think that finally, you know, that why didn't we think of that before? Gosh. Yeah. Yeah, we can both be completely abiding in truth and also at the same time completely impervious to it. Completely impervious. Can't touch us at all. There's no conflict there, right? Yeah. So they're desperately marketing this nonsense in the world right now. Trying to confuse the issue and claim that, you know, that you going along with this just proves how smart you are. What it really proves is you're still going along with the attempt to be impervious to truth. Those who go along with it are trying to basically say, we're so impervious to truth that even this complete madness, we accept this complete madness and that'll help us be impervious to truth. Yeah, that both truth and lies are true. And by accepting that as the new truth, we hope to become impervious to truth and win the contest. So this is the upshot of a book such as this, Course in Miracles, is the ability to see this in very clear, simple way like this. And we you know, arrogance, this tactic doesn't work because we are truth. God created us. What God created us can never be changed or uncreated in any way. So God created us as truth and freedom and love. And we can't not feel that deep within us. It's impossible. So we never feel like we've quite succeeded in becoming impervious to truth. And therefore, we are willing to then take a look and say, oftentimes you say, well, why am I failing? You know, I've tried so hard and I'm still failing. I still feel vulnerable to truth. And then you have to begin looking and recognizing, what have I been doing really all this time? What have I really been engaged in? And then you see it and you say, wow. Oh, wow. And we're told in this world that we're just about succeeded in becoming impervious to truth. And as soon as everybody uses this technique of accepting this compromise that both truth and lies can be true at the same time, yet they're both entertained both equally in the mind, then we'll enter this golden age where we will have won the contest with God, and therefore we will be experiencing perfect happiness. And this is what people believe they're headed towards. And of course, if you tell them, well, that's not true, you know, they say, oh, how dare you try to touch me with truth. I'm almost succeeded in becoming impervious, so don't, stay away. And then, of course, they're in such a drunken state of arrogance, drunk on arrogance, that you can't really reach them. And then later on, they'll say, well, how come you didn't help me back then? You know, and you will have to say, because you were attempting to become impervious, so you're like extremely drunk on the wine of arrogance. And, you know, it just couldn't get through to you at that point. But we did maintain our viability to get through to you later, so all's well that ends well, right? So at some point, they'll become amenable to reason. And you won't have to struggle so severely. So we're just doing a little full stop in the wow here. Let us recognize that this is just an extraordinary perspective here. I've never reached this perspective before, so this brings to light the so-called perversity of human nature, doesn't it? The obstinacy, the stubbornness, what's the problem, you know, like an insane asylum here. It's not really an insane asylum at all, actually. It's very purposeful. Everyone really knows exactly what they're doing here. They may pretend not to, but they do. Because to recognize they know exactly what they're doing would mean that being touched by truth. So not only do they are trying to be impervious to truth, they're impervious to recognizing that they're trying to be impervious to truth. So it's like, you know, double down. It's always double down here. And I see the implications of this are just off the charts, right? I mean, this basically flips an enormous script. It flips the whole script here, doesn't it? And of course, if we don't want to be touched by truth, we'll try to avoid feeling this flip, try and avoid recognizing it. All our hubris of trying to define for ourselves what we're doing here and what's going on here. Now we recognize that was all just distraction. It was all just distraction. It's all just distraction. So this is one of those insights that is slow building, but you can, I can feel the implications are so staggering that it's better to, you know, play it cautious here. You know, it's a slow fuse. But so what we're doing is preemptively going into the wow mode, preemptively shifting into neutral coasting, preemptively doing that. You know, see, the full wow hasn't struck me yet, but I'm preemptively saying, oh, I know it will. So so you see how we're just preemptively just sitting quietly here. It's like you said, I think that tsunami's coming, so I better get off the beach or something, you know, just when the tsunami comes, you're not touched by it. That's, that particular wow reaction, I mean, it's not the right word to use in context of this video, not touched by it. You're not panicked by it. You're not panicked into retreat. You've already done your retreat. You're not panicked into retreat. The tsunami comes and you're already in higher ground and it just, okay, it comes in, it recedes and all is fine. No worries. So imagine if you were on the seashore and all the water, the ocean started dropping in its elevation, started like the tide was going out very fast, and you know the things were being uncovered, the ocean bottom was being uncovered, and you said, "Wow, this is very bizarre. Why is the tide dropping so severely so fast?" And then you have to say, "Wait a minute, you know, this is what happens when there's a tsunami, a big earthquake, and a tsunami coming." And so what do? You keep walking along the beach and say, oh, look at this tide pool that's been uncovered. Oh, look at the fish in there. Look at all this. Oh, let me take pictures of this. Maybe look at this. It might be very interesting to you, right? But if you're smart, you'll say, hey, wait a minute. I think, you know, the best move is to just get up that mountain as fast as possible. And then, so you leave the beach and you get up that mountain and then you're there and you're safe. And then when the tsunami comes in, sweeps over the beach and the lowlands and it recedes, and you know, you're just sitting up there and you're fine. You weren't hit by it. I mean, it's still a huge wow thing to see the tsunami come in, right? But you weren't swept away by it. You weren't swept away. So this preemptive approach enables them when the wow really gets so strong, you know, we're not swept away by it. We're not panicked by it. so this practice is so successful that it was able to get me to see this insight, which is, I've never heard this anywhere or read anything like this. And yet it is the most accurately descriptive perspective on this world that I've ever come across. And so, I'm preemptively backing off, going and coasting into neutral here, going to higher ground. And this is how, you know, this practice has enabled this insight to arise in the first place, for sure. Now, what I'm feeling is there's this sort of inner shakiness, trembling, sort of a deep trembling, not showing up in the body so much, but I can feel it in a nervous way, like I just really pulled the plug, you know, and what's going to happen next? It's kind of like this: oh my gosh, now that I've seen that, what is going to happen next? And so this kind of a slow building, wow. So it's kind of like I'm in higher, climbed up a hill, and I'm looking down over the beach now, just observing. I'm certainly not going to go back down on the beach after this kind of insight, no, because it's likely to be a tsunami coming. It's like a psychic earthquake just happened. And this sort of insight often results in some sort of fatigue. You tend to shut down. It's a reaction to it, you know, instead of staying with it. So you may be sitting on a hill, and someone may come along and say, "What are you doing?" I say, "Well, watching the beach." "Oh, why?" "Well, there, you know, I think there might be a tsunami coming in." "Oh, really?" "Well, you know, I don't think there's going to be one. And I'm going to go down there." And you might say, no, I'm not going to go down there. Better safe than sorry. Better safe than sorry. So, just experience this, as it teaches us that when you have these extreme perspective shifts like this, there is a backlash that comes. At some point, and those who say, "Well, it didn't come immediately, so it's not going to come at all," you know, those are fools. They go down to the beach, and the tsunami comes at some point and sweeps them away. funny thing about tsunamis, when they happen infrequently, you think that you end up thinking, well, maybe they're a myth, because it's they're up until the Boxing Day Indonesian tsunami. We hadn't had any real big tsunamis, I don't think, for quite some time here. And you end up kind of thinking like maybe it's just a myth that the people in the past just exaggerated it, you know, some sort of a severe exaggeration. And then when one really strikes, and we realize, and the Fukushima tsunami in Japan, you know, that was like even more dramatic, extraordinary. And what we find out is the older generations going way back, they had like put up markers and signs and stuff for subsequent generations to saying, look, this is how high the tsunami water came. You better, you know, don't build any lower than this. And, you know, but people ignored those signs after a while. They just completely ignored them, like, ah, we don't know why they put that there. Maybe there's some other reason we can't understand why they did that. It's amazing, isn't it, that we can take that sort of approach to it and say, oh, maybe there's no such thing. They're just exaggerating or making it up. But then when one strikes, we know, oh my gosh, they weren't making it up. This is terrible. And so people might think that we're exaggerating, you know, the caution about this backlashes. I say, oh, there shouldn't be any problem with that. Yeah, this one is so extreme that it's trying to lull me to sleep. This insight literally turns all explanation and history basically upside down on its head, and renders it basically meaningless. I've already said that all politics here are spiritual politics. That is for sure. It reveals the true motivation of what's going on here. This is just a tremendous quantum leap for us. Blacking out almost here. Blacked out for a moment there. Wow. So the game of distraction is trying to arise. Now I'm seeing that. Now maybe the tsunami is not going to hit me because I've done so much work. Maybe, you know, but again, abundance of caution is very important. Maybe to be touched by this realization is basically that's it. For arrogance, that's it. You know, so maybe I'm avoiding being touched by it in some way, because it's so strong. I can feel it, that this is a difference maker. It holds the key as to why the Holy Spirit's able to tell us where to go, what to do, who to talk to, what to say. Because the Holy Spirit can see into the true state of affairs here and recognize that not everybody that is speaking in a spiritual way is necessarily doing it because they want to be touched by truth. They may be rehearsing, practicing not being touched by it. And once you recognize that this is the case here in this world, then you feel you could be guided truly, you know, and you'll not be confused by it. The Holy Spirit says, you know, go here and do this. Then you say, okay, I'll trust that. And it knows its business. Whereas trying to judge superficially in this world, we can continuously stumble and make mistakes. And now I'm seeing why. Jesus talks about this in the parable of the sower and the seeds falling on shallow ground underneath which are rocks. He says those kind of people, this is like the people who initially have a ton of enthusiasm when they hear what you're saying, and then a little while later, they suddenly flip and are your worst enemy, and they think that you're trying to trick them and betray them, and you know, basically they get the feeling, hey, this is going to make me lose the contest with God. Oh, this is terrible, you know. Oh, hey, I've been touched by this. Oh, that's awful, you know. This is a reaction. They listen, they say, oh, this person's talking in the way that we're used to talking spiritually. We like hearing this because it helps us practice not being touched. And then you realize, hey, wait a minute, they mean for us to be touched by this. Oh, that's terrible. What a terrible teacher they are, you know. That's what Jesus is getting at. Or maybe it's because I went very preemptive on this, recognizing very quickly, you know, how profound it is that there somehow has taken the air out of the sails of the backlash, you know, the being hit real strong and swept away by the wow. You don't want to be swept away by the wow. The wow is a mixture of elation and trepidation, but it's not our goal. It's not our goal. We need to allow the wow to be touched by the wow, for sure. Allow it to take place. But at the same time, stay neutral towards it. So this video is a perfect example of right spiritual practice. You get touched by truth, you see it. But then realize that there's going to be this wow reaction at some point, and preemptively prepare for it. All sorts of distracting trains of thought trying to come in and you know, pull the attention off of the recognition. So you just stay poised in this. This is the practice. It's brought us this far to see this most astonishing principle at work here. And you can even say that we come to this world, incarnate, precisely in order to work on trying to be impervious to truth. That's why we come here. This just pretty much rewrites the entire book of all psychology, doesn't it? And sociology and everything. Again, thoughts arise that are distracting. Have to shake them off and say, no, that's not it. Use your will. Don't get sucked up in a storyline of some thoughts developing into a storyline to see where it will take you. Just immediately opt out like that. This is real meditation. Real meditation when you're touched by truth and handling your success. That's real meditation. A lot of fake meditation going on where you're really trying to just improve your imperviousness to truth. I mean this you in a collective sense. Not anyone in particular. Now the psyche might be saying, well, this is too much, yeah, all at once, you know, to flip the entire script here of most of accumulated belief here, to flip the whole belief system like this, of, you know, what we're here for in general. We have, you know, so much telling us this and this and that, and just to suddenly flip it all. Now, I asked last night, I said, I'm ready to see all bodies as just light, and the whole world is just light. Let all bodies appear to be light bodies. Let this world appear to be a light world. I said, I'm ready for that. I'm willing to do that. Which means you stop buying time. Seeing the world as a world and seeing bodies as bodies, all we're doing is buying time. That's it. Just buying time, buying time. To do what? To become impervious to truth. Why? To win the contest with God. Why? To prove that we're to become the new prime creator, to be greater than God now, to usurp the position of the prime creator, the one who created perfection. To sow seed bodies and see the world, that's the agenda that we're pursuing. So I said, I'm ready to see bodies in not as flesh, but as light. Like sort of just sort of a glowing outline of light, and I'm willing to see the world as all is, again, just this nothing but light. I'm willing to see everything is only light, and to see it. And so I was really willing to do that, and I asked that this take place. So maybe this insight here is a corollary to that, getting ready to flip the perceptual script. First, flip the conceptual script, and the next, flip the perceptual script. Of course, light is not fixated. It's free, right? I mean, it's invulnerable. You can't say there's any contest taking place. You can't say it's vulnerable. Somebody today called me, someone who used to know my name. They said, your name is what? Is Dawn? You know, Dawn? And I said, that's interesting. Someone referred to me as Dawn, meaning it's someone who's dawning. The dawn is upon them. So maybe that was a sign that the dawn will be upon me of seeing everything as light instead of matter, instead of time, space, process, and form. It's all just light. Even the electromagnetic light is just, see, that is just light, as true light. It's just an appearance within light. So the light that we're speaking about here is not this electromagnetic solar light. Seeing bodies as light doesn't mean that you see them as electromagnetic energy or light, no. I've already had an experience like that where in my mind's eye, all bodies appeared to be kind of just this sort of a general outline of a body, but it was all just this light, and you couldn't really see any features of anybody at all. Everybody looked the same. They're like just sort of wearing a robe of light. You couldn't determine their hair, their facial features, their gender, nothing. It was all the same. Just light. And then the world they were standing on also was a world that was glowing. It was just light. So what we're doing when we have these insights is we don't retreat. We keep us. Hold our ground. Stop trying to advance and make sure that you don't retreat. You know, so that's what I'm trying to do here, to make sure I don't retreat from this. And give it some time, give it some time. After all, flipping the script on everything you ever thought to be true in about this world, it deserves a little time to let that sink in, right? To realize, oh, this is what we're here for. This is why we're pretending to have bodies and be dwelling in a world. And again, you have to prove to yourself that you can do this over and over again, that you can handle the wow of this. And just yesterday I was thinking, you know, I'm ready for a really big wow. I know I can handle it. And so here it is. Now, pretty much renders everything that's ever been taught in this world is void. And so you have to be ready for that. You know, you can't be attached to all this stuff. Since I don't pay attention, you know, to any of that stuff, really, just like that, doesn't make any difference. Doesn't make any difference at all. Obviously, if you're trying to get a good grade in school, you might be worried about this, because then you've lost your motivation. Say, there's no point in studying any of that any longer. If you're trying to pose as an expert in some explanation about this world, and you see this, you just say, oh, wow. I got to drop that old explanation. It's not true. And then you no longer seem to be an expert in it. So it's you know, it's good to be lowly in this world and anonymous and lowly, and because this enables you to open up to this tremendous script flipping, and it doesn't bother you so much. So I got nothing to lose. Another very interesting clue happened today. The number 15 has always been vitally important for me for some reason. Well, we're in the 15th year of this millennium, aren't we? And I was told maybe about 11 years ago, just wait about 15 minutes and then you will be saved. And at that time, I thought, it's impossible. I can't wait until 2015. That's absolutely ridiculous. Well, here we are. So I'm at somewhere today, and I ordered 16 bags of something. And someone loaded these bags up, and when I got to pay for it, he made a note of how many bags he loaded. I got to pay for it. The note said, not 16, but 15. And so I assumed, oh, he loaded 15 bags. Wow, okay. He actually didn't. He loaded 16, but he put down 15. And I accepted it. I say, okay, all right, so be it. 15, that's okay. The dawn, you know, occurring in 2015. Right on time. And again, I'm not going to try to rush into too much here. Still, I'm saying that, you know, fragile. Got to be fragile when you see something like this. There's a certain amount of fragility okay, within the psyche, because the script is flipped to such an extent. How did this get moved? Interesting. I don't know. Maybe I tugged on this cord and it got moved like that. It must have been like that. Okay. So we move it back. Now, the wows, they may all feel a little bit different from one another. So, you know, no two are maybe exactly alike. This one, I might have gone into some sort of shock. It's possible. And then as the shock wears off, I'll start feeling really strong. I mean, I just know somebody just had a very dangerous situation happen to them. And, you know, that day they're still, you know, oh, I'm okay, everything's fine, they got through it, and it's not like nothing's wrong. And then, you know, day later, suddenly they start shaking, and it's like super nervous and anxious, like, wow, you know, delayed reaction. Oftentimes, we go into shock, and something's real scary, we go into shock and keep driving, and everything's fine. And later on, you know, just, oh my God, it's just like, that was so terrible, it was so close, that's horrible. So you have to factor in the delayed reaction to shock. Certainly seeing this is stunning, very shocking. That it's a, you know, we're all told there's, you know, I can never understand. Well, this is a theory that fits. It explains so much behavior that was previously unexplicable. We just came up with thousands of plausible explanations for it. None of them quite fit. And then this one just fits perfectly. So we're told that when we go to see an enlightened master, that we should come in the mood of feeling that we're going to spend our time sitting quietly, very poised and sitting quietly. Well, that's because you're very likely to be quite stunned. So this is very good advice. This is why I say practice. It will open up the door for you being able to. You know, be in the presence of someone who's able to convey truth to you that is very stunning and very helpful. So you're practicing, you're not being non-argumentative, non-reactive, full stop, neutral mode. So if you ever go see someone, if you're ever in touch with someone, if you're in some way who's enlightened, be sure you go into that practicing this non-reactive full stop in the wow practice, and make sure that you do your very best at that. You're not engaging in any back and forth with whatever gave you the stunning information. You're not engaging in any back and forth. You're saying, wow, this may hit me, may have a delayed reaction, very strong. Now you can see why some who go up to a teacher like in satsang and they may be saying, oh wow, it's like, yeah, I'm so this, oh wow, and the teacher, the guru may say, you sure you're not just faking this? You know, you sure you're not just faking this? They can feel the lack of genuineness, because someone is just trying to say, I'm here now, and the purpose for being here is to practice being untouched by truth. So I'm going to give all these fake reactions, but inside I'm really not being touched by it. So it's something, phony about it. That happens very often. And someone else may come up and be so quiet and stuff and say, wow, that they too may be just faking that, being quiet, pretending to be touched by it, and it's still phony. What's that? Oh, okay. But then again, sometimes there is a wow reaction that is like, wow, and also sometimes quiet, very quiet. And it's genuine. It's genuine. Might be some interruption here. I don't know. Looks like there may be... No. So again, it's up to you to be genuine. It's always possible to fake it. It's always possible to fake it. But for you, if you know that it's genuine, you will know it. But the full stop on the wow, you do not emote. Do not emote. Be quiet. See, the cat is emoting. Don't pay any attention to the cat. It's emoting. We're staying quiet. It's trying to distract. Don't pay attention to it. So this is a slow burning. Wow. This is what is slow burning. It's like a slow wildfire. Because the overtones of it, the implications are just so enormous. The enormity of it is just immeasurable. So, the reaction is not quite sure how to react. And that in itself can be a strong wow if you're not really sure how to react, right? Because you can't measure it. You say, wow, this is really, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to react. Very strong wow. That's part of the wow. The wow is often, it's some immeasurable. You glimpse something that's immeasurable, and you don't know how to react, and so you feel like, wow, what, this is really kind of, I'm shocked. Climbing a tree, running around, yowling or anything, and not being distracted by it. That's an example of one who is not practicing, spiritual practicing, not full stopping in the wow, not being touched by truth. It's all full of antics. This bird is scolding the cat. Very much so. Of course, the bird's all revved up. It's not practicing full stop in the wow either. So, there's a perfect example of practicing full stop in the wow, how it opens the door. How it opens the door to really seeing something that is just colossally important. Seeing the colossal importance of this and being able to handle that. Maintain your equilibrium, your poise. And to be touched by this colossal importance, to really feel it and still say, okay, it's okay. And then bear the sensitivity. Don't try to show off and say, oh, okay, that didn't bother me. Now I'm going to go on and try to get more insights. No, to preemptively say, hey, this is a stunning insight. I'm going to spend an hour just sitting here quietly or however long. I'm just going to make sure that you know, I don't lose my equilibrium over this. So, interestingly enough, this is the most important type of, you know, conveyance, is conveying, you know, exactly how it goes. And so how you can say, hey, let me try this too. I can do this. It's not all about verbiage. It's just as much about full stop in the wow, because success is going to stun you. You will be stunned by it, because the implications, the flipped scripting, the script flipping, not the flip scripting, the script flipping is so enormous. You can't help but be stunned by it. I mean, it's just basically put yourself in a different world, as it were. You know, the world that I knew just vanished. The world that I thought that I knew has just vanished. The dynamic, the society that I thought I knew has just vanished. The history that I thought I knew has just vanished. Everything that I thought I knew, almost everything, has just vanished. Gone. Replaced with this fundamental clarity here. Replaced. So, this is why it's so important to practice this full stop in the wow. How else can you do it? How else can you do it? And stay steady and then enter into the, you know, vision of light. And then people will say, oh, you're enlightened now. Seeing everything as light. And they use the term enlightened. You see everything as light. Everything is light instead of form. Everything is inherently light. It's not reflective light. It's inherently light. So it's not bound by time and space at all. When we talk about light being bound by time and space, we're talking about electromagnetism, we call that light. But the real light, everything's already that. And it's not bound by time and space, process, or form. See, I'm free. That means everything I'm seeing is light. Is light. It's all part of the freedom that I am. The freedom of I am. again, we won't struggle with that. Don't struggle when we're in this wow. Don't struggle too much. If you feel this feeling is too much of a struggle, just drop it. Just drop it. Okay, how are we doing here? Up in the 140s. Wow. That's great. So don't be afraid of these blockbuster insights and clarifications. You know, you can sit quiet. You can sit quiet. You don't have to then get anything more, you know, during this time of practicing. One massive insight like this is more than enough for this one time, you see. Don't try to get more. Don't get greedy. Now once this shock wears off, then other insights will come. You'll be able to put it all together, and it'll be great. But right now, don't try to put it all together. This is enough. This is enough to just stay poised in this insight. I'm going to try and just keep... I'm trying to go back on a smoothie diet. I got off of it, and my weight started shooting back up, and now I'm back on it a little bit, and it started to drop again. So I'm gonna try and, you know, try and do this. I don't know if I can. It's not easy, but the good thing about going on a smoothie, you know, juice smoothie, whatever. This is it's a one banana, one orange, and a bit of fresh lemon and orange mango juice. Okay, so it's very tasty, very tasty. Blends of mango juice, like with one really good one is lemonade mango blend. There's we have this company that makes it. It's called Santa Cruz, I think, organic drinks here in glass bottles, and you can get this lemonade mango. Very good mixer for smoothies. Very, very good. Try lemon mango juice with a banana. A bunch of organic strawberries and a bunch of organic blueberries, and wow, that is really, really, really good. Yeah, see this wow, it was a slow moving wow, and I'm feeling it now. It's slow developing. Shock. Coming out of the shock. It's a very shocking insight. So now the thing to do is just focus on this shock and just, you know, keep poised and just let it subside. Let it subside. So I was right about this. I was right about it. I said, you know, something this big, look out for the delayed reaction. Go into a shock and then everything feels fine, but later on, the shock wears off and you start feeling jittery, you know. The wow is really strong. So, well, good thing about going on these juice diets for a little while is that the bubbles are rising. That's cool. Once you drop, you know, 4 pounds, 4 or 5 pounds, you can eat again. You can eat again. It's interesting. I found that in diets, I can drop 4 or 5 pounds, but then I plateau and I can't go any further. And so, even if I diet for 6 months and keep trying, I still just kind of stay. It just doesn't can't seem to drop, go any further for some reason. So I say, well, then, you know, why not just, okay, say, okay, I can easily drop 4 or 5 pounds. And then just then, instead of trying to just starve myself and it doesn't work, just go back to eating again. Go back to eating again. Maybe then I'll gain, you know, 4 or 5 pounds back. Then at some point I'll say, okay, and then I'll just go another juice diet and lose 4 or 5 pounds. The key is don't let it get out of control. And watch what you eat. You know, there's some smart things like ice cream. I found this ice cream now, slow-churned Breyer's ice cream or something, that is half the fat, half the butter fat. It's just much less calories, much less fattening, and also uses stevia or Splenda. Uses Splenda, something like that, for the sugar, the sweetness. And so there's much less sugar, like 3 grams of sugar. So it's not nearly as fattening, but it actually tastes great. It actually tastes great. So you can even eat a little ice cream. You can even eat some apple pie. Some apple pie doesn't have much sugar in it at all. It's mostly apples and some crust. It's not so fattening. Then occasionally eat some dinners just like salad and some vegetables. That's it. Maybe I'll have a little salad with some vegetables tonight. And then, so in the other nights you can have a, you know, whatever you like. But one thing I found, avoid potato chips and corn chips. That's the one that really can do you in. There's certain kind of snacks, like crackers too. If you're snacking on crackers, a lot of crackers, there's certain things that are real bad. Pizza's not so bad, actually. If you get veggie pizza, it's just it's got this thin crust veggie pizza, not or just medium crust, but and some tomato sauce and some cheese and some vegetables. It's not so bad at all, pizza. Chips and dip. Ah, that will destroy you. Cheese dip. So we're just sitting here in the wow of this, letting it cool down a little bit. Not trying to remember what was the insight. No. The earthquake has already struck. We're just staying off the beach right now. So I'm paying the price for having been eating, you know, fairly well for a while now, so I'll pay the price, you know, drop the pounds. We're at a time where it's easy to just decide, to heck with it, I'm going to eat everything I want to eat. Times are so shocking, so brutal. I just deserve this. So it's important not to do that, because that'll develop all sorts of issues for you in a lot of different ways. It's funny, every time I start getting into that mood of overeating, I come across someone with a big belly, you know, and they'll like say something, they'll pat their belly or say something. It's like, wow, you know, I'm so out of shape, and this is like, yeah, I'm carrying so much extra weight, you know, and in some way they'll draw my attention, like, oh my gosh, I don't want to do that. I could easily be like, you know, go in that direction right now, easily. And so I get scared straight, you know. Being scared straight is actually can be helpful. So, whoa, stop. You're at the brink, stop. And the stress of this path of walking together in the wow, you know, can lead you to saying, oh, wow, I just want to, you know, eat. So it's very important, as part of the discipline of this path, is to sure, sometimes you can eat, that's okay. But then you put yourself through like a four-day juice, you know, reduction thing, smoothie reduction. I'm trying to do it. I started yesterday, Thursday, then I'll do Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Try to do it, you know, for 4 days. See if I can just do a 4-day smoothie reduction and maybe drop, you know, 3-4 pounds. So manage your success and be aware that because of the stress of this wow, you may try to overindulge in something, you know. As I say, the sex, the drugs, and rock and roll, you know, stay away from that stuff. That's rule it out. And then watch your diet. Don't start pigging out. It's easy to do. Like for me, if I just went down and got a box of, you know, cheese puffs or cheese whiz or whatever they call them, corn chips, big bag of corn chips and some dip, and I can just go through the whole bag. Just go through the whole bag straight. Well, that's going to put like about 3 pounds on me. So you just don't do it. Just don't do it. Another trick, here's a trick for to help you out with this, is you may start doing it. And I did this today. I started eating chips and I had a full mouth. And I said, wait a minute, what am I doing? This is stupid, you know. And so I just made a lump, like a ball in my mouth, and just spit it out and just threw it away. I didn't swallow it. I said, forget it. Did that with some crackers, did that with some corn chips. So you might find yourself starting to eat something you know you shouldn't eat. And say, wait, you don't have to swallow it just because you put it in your mouth. You know, just make a nice little ball and spit it out and throw it down the garbage disposal, throw it in the trash. And you at least got the taste of that salt there, you know. It's okay. So watch your, don't indulge, you know, don't indulge in anything when you're in this shock of this tremendous breakthrough. This is just a colossal breakthrough that happened today. You know, I can't even measure it. So not going to try to measure it. Just let it be. And then make sure I don't, you know, go out the deep end in any way here. Don't start watching some movie, you know, get wrapped up in some drama. Don't do that. I might watch a little baseball here, you know, go back and forth. Don't get too wrapped up in that. The Giants are playing great. San Francisco Giants are playing great right now. They're secret. I know their secret. It's so freaking cold at AT&T Park this May has been. It's like playing in a refrigerator. It's so cold. It has just been brutally cold there. And the other teams come in. They come in from, you know, it's hot. The rest of the country is warm, hot, warm. They're used to coming. They're used to that. They come in here, and they basically can't function. They can't hit. They can't throw. They can't do anything. It's like playing in a refrigerator, inside a big refrigerator. Or, you know, cooler box, going to Costco, and they got this huge area where all the vegetables are, and it's so cold in there, right? It's like playing inside that. I mean, they can't, and the Giants players are used to that. So they can function a little bit better than the other players, so they end up winning all these games. There's been, like, the last 12 home games, the Giants pitchers have had 8 shutouts in the last 12. That is just almost unfathomable how that's possible. Because the other team is, like, so cold, you know, they don't even want to hit. They say, I don't even want to go up to the plate. If I get jammed on a pitch, it's going to buzz my hands so bad, it's just going to be so painful. You know, so painful. Nothing like frozen hands and then getting hit on the handle of the bat, and the reverberations go into your hands, and you just, like, you want to just feel like your hands are falling off, crumpling. It's terrible. That's their secret. That's one of their secrets. Super home field advantage. How do you go pitch 8 shutouts in 12 games? That's ridiculous. That has a lot to do with the weather. And plus, the ball doesn't fly anywhere. No matter how hard you hit the ball, it doesn't go out of the park. There's no way. And I'm sure tonight's going to be another extremely cold night up there. This May in San Francisco has been just one of the brutal, brutally cold months up there. If you want winter, just come to San Francisco in summer, they say. People say the coldest winter I ever spent was summer in San Francisco. That is very true. I once went up to a game down here. It was like, 95, and just gorgeous, blistering hot summer day. I went up in a tank top, in a convertible up to Candlestick Park in San Francisco, and it's by the time I hit this fog bank and was in a convertible and I was on the freeway. I didn't stop. By the time I got to the park, I was like an ice cube, and then I proceeded to just freeze even more. And I was just, it was horrible, horrible. Never did that again. The fans up there are all bundled up in parkas and ski jackets and hoods and scarves and gloves and, drinking hot chocolate or coffee or something. They're just like trying to survive. And the players are out there freezing. So the wow is continuing, A lot of turbulence because of the potency of this recognition, the shock of it, the extent of it, so there's a lot of subtle turbulence. So basically, now you just have to live with this. Now you've seen it. You can't put it back. You open the box. You see what's inside. You repackage it. What's the use? You know what's inside already, right? You've seen this movie. You already know how it ends. So I just have to just live with this truth. I have to live with it. That's all. Get used to it. Get used to living with this truth. All right, it's starting to get a little cool out here. And so that's why I can tell, and I'm sure that San Francisco is really cold. I've gone over 2 hours already. That's great. The wow continues, and you just have to keep managing it. Don't jump into something when you've had a blockbuster insight like this. Really flip the script. Don't jump into something else. Don't jump into some big project. Don't challenge yourself in any way. It's enough of a challenge to get used to this and living with this new truth, okay? That is the challenge. This is a huge challenge. This is the challenge that Jesus calls us to, is this progressive recognition of truth gradually, and then living with this truth as we uncover more and more clarity. We have to live with this then, and it's quite a challenge. Quite a challenge. And you can see now the difference between the sheep and the goats is obviously the huge difference, right? The ones who are taking on this challenge and the ones who are trying to become impervious to truth, obviously they're going in very different directions, have a very different agenda. All right. So the wow is still very strongly reverberating. And don't try to end it, because something like this, it's going to be extended. It's going to extend out for sure. This is like an extraordinarily consequential recognition. So of course, the wow is going to extend with this. Just be patient, 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 patient. Patient, patient, patient. allow the roots, you know, to grow on this clarity. Allow the roots to really sink in. That's what Jesus is talking about. He says some of the seeds will fall in fertile soil and the roots go real deep. And when the roots go real deep, then that anchors the plant. The plant can get all the nutrition and moisture it needs to grow really strong and secure. And it'll grow into this very big plant that will then put off, you know, a great deal of fruit. So just focus on the letting this wow subside, whatever wow that you got out of this. Don't rush off to some venture, you know, don't try to do some extraordinary challenge. If you're creative, don't try to be super creative. Don't try to translate this into some sign of super creativity. No, just be blah. Just be normal, just be blah. Be humble, it's very meek, unassuming, humble. Don't try to excel. Okay, this challenge that we have right now is more than enough challenge. It's a great challenge, actually, a very great challenge. So the greatness is in accepting these challenges. That's where the greatness is. And ultimately, the greatness will become evident, will shine forth. You'll see everything as light, eventually. Okay, very great. There's a perfect time to say, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow.